peaceful eyes. Cellophane flowers of yellow and green towering over
our heads. Dr. Bryan Bayles from the Center for Integrative Health. He's in the Department of Family and Community Medicine. And I think one of the interesting things that's happened in the past, I think it's only been like 5 years, but time flies, I could be wrong, is that we now have a new National Institute of Health. You know, we have National Institute of Dental and Craniofacial Research, and there's a National Institute of Aging. Well, we now have a National Institute of Complementary and Alternative Medicine. And if you think about that for just a minute, that's kind of interesting, because this is where we do tests that prove, for example, that yes, those of us in menopause who take black cohosh actually have less severe hot flash symptoms. So this is a whole world that's opening up, I think, to the practice of healthcare all across the board. And it's an exciting opportunity, I think, for a lot of us to be involved. And we already know, for example, that tomorrow one of our speakers is not going to be here because his brother-in-law, it's either his brother or his brother-in-law, is dying and he can't come, and I'm going to give a nutrition talk. And one of the things that I'm going to talk about is roles in which dental hygienists in particular, as well as other members, I mean, we've got nursing here too, and psychology. I want to talk about a little bit in there about new roles for dental hygiene in terms of nutrition counseling and learning more about this area. And this complementary and alternative medicine is a really excellent entree into that area
also,
as well.
There's some interesting work going on as well in sort of alternative therapies for pain control and pain management.
Okay.
In dentistry.
This is good. So get started. This is excellent.
Okay. As usual, I always bring way too many slides, so I'm going to try to keep it as brief as possible. But I would like to open it up so we have some discussion. Can you all hear me? Okay,
mm-hmm. Cool.
I'm Bryan Bayles. Just a real quick background on who I am. I'm actually an anthropologist, which most people are like, "Hey, don't you study dinosaurs?" That's paleontology. But I will say a medical school environment is kind of the last place I thought I'd end up. But it's kind of a long circuitous route about how I got here. But my background research and my doctoral work was done in the south of Mexico in Chiapas on the border of Guatemala, where I worked with traditional healers. Traditional Mayan indigenous healers there, primarily midwives, studying reproductive health and childbirth. I also teach, my wife and I both teach natural childbirth classes. And so I got into a very strong interest developed in traditional therapies, alternative healing, herbal medicine, plant remedies. After that, having moved, oh, by the way, I'm the one on the left in that picture on the bottom. Just, I don't exactly blend when I'm down there. And this is a picture of one of the midwives and just laying out a number of the medicinal plants that she uses. And one of the reasons I bring this up is that the traditions of folk healing and traditional therapies, particularly in the Mexican-American community here in South Texas, have very deep roots in Latin America. And there are a number of similarities culturally between the practices of medicine, traditional medicine, in these small rural communities, and some of the traditions that are finding their way into primary care patients and here in South Texas. There are some changes, some interesting differences as well, but let me see. I just wanted to show a couple. Here in Texas, I've been involved in a couple of different studies of curanderos and yerberos, who are sort of traditional folk healers, Mexican-American folk healers here in town and in the lower Rio Grande Valley, looking at the role of spirituality in healing, as well as the issue of diabetes care. This is a, I like to show this picture because it's a, this is a fellow, a yerbero here in San Antonio on the west side, in his backyard, where he grows the majority of the medicinal plants that he uses in his practice. And he does see a lot of patients, and this is very typical of some of the alternative healers that are out here in our community here and down in South Texas, that many of them work out of the home, little or minimal schooling or background, but nonetheless practice their craft, which many of them have inherited from their parents and their grandparents, and there are many generations within their family that have served as healers. So a number of patients that we see in the conventional system are also availing themselves of these healers in their community. And there's very little dialogue right now, as it is, between these folks and the conventional healthcare system. And that's something we're really working to try to improve and get better communication and dialogue going about. And as I'll show you, there's a number of reasons why that's very important. But I've also been doing some ethnographic work in some of these botanicas or medicinal herb shops. How many of you have ever been in one here in town or in? Not many. Well, essentially, I would really, really encourage it, particularly if you're going to practice or in this community or anywhere in South Texas, I really would encourage you to spend a little time. There's over, we documented about 50 of these shops here in San Antonio alone. They're very small. They're little storefront places, particularly down on the south side and the west side. If you look up in the phone book, you know, you'll get a whole list of under, what are they usually under? Sometimes herbal, if you look under herbal, or pharmacies even, sometimes they'll be listed under. But they're essentially, they sell a number of items, candles, medicinal plants that are sold in bulk and prepackaged. And I have my little visual display here of a number of books that, you know, when you get a chance, if you want to come down and just look at them. But also, I also brought some of the products that you know, they sell in these shops. These are sort of prepackaged. This is a diabetes treatment that's very common, very popular here in South Texas, as is this. This is a té diabético, which most of these products are produced and grown in Mexico and then imported in. This is a veladora, a candle that's often used for cleansing, spiritual healing, a number of things. I won't go too much into the historical roots, but El Niño Fidencio was a very, very famous healer from South Texas. There's a shrine to him down, if you go down to the valley, I can't remember the little town's name, Falfurrias, I think? Yeah. There's a shrine to him, which is a very popular sort of pilgrimage site for some folks who practice traditional healing. But here at the Health Science Center, we have established a Center for Integrative Health, basically, it was set up by the president's office. We got some money from President Figueroa because we approached him and we said, you know, this is an area that needs to be looked at, and it's growing in popularity. We showed him some data, and he said, you're right. We need to jump on this. We need to do something. So we've only been in existence for 2.5 years, or 3 years now. The majority of that time has been spent going around campus, finding interested folks, and putting together our advisory board with representatives from each of the campuses, getting our web page up and running, which it's undergoing a major overhaul right now, but I encourage you to look at it at some point in the near future. But essentially our goal is to conduct research on the safety and education and effectiveness, safety and efficacy of some of these complementary and alternative therapies and document their prevalence and use in our community. What I want to do today, what I hope to accomplish, which I won't get through all this, I'm sure, is just a basic overview of the field, which is a huge field, and there's a lot of different ways we can look at it, but then give you some data on specifically on diabetes and some of the therapies that are popular, that we're finding are very popular in the Mexican-American community. And then if we have time, I may just touch on this, is I want to kind of reiterate the importance of considering individuals' cultural beliefs and cultural models or explanatory framework when approaching the treatment of diabetes in particular, as I'm going to use some examples. So what are we talking about here when we say complementary and alternative medicine? There's a lot of debate in the field about what the best term for what we're talking about here is. Complementary, you know, evokes the idea, which is what the term that's usually used in Europe is the idea that many of these therapies are used together with conventional care. Alternative implying that folks turn to it as opposed to conventional care. There's really a push now to talk about a new model of healing and healthcare that we call integrative medicine or integrative health, which, you know, incorporates the best of both worlds. There are some major challenges to this, not the least of which is improving the communication among different practitioners with very different, working from very different frameworks of how the body works and how medicine works. But nonetheless, in integrative medicine, you know, there's a real focus now on placing the individual in the context, in their social context, their cultural context, their spiritual context, because, you know, as we know, healing takes place on all of these levels, and all of which are important to the healing of an individual. There's also a strong emphasis that your patient is a partner in the process of healing, that they have inherent capabilities within themselves to heal that we can draw upon and foster and nurture to improve their healing. So again, it is not a rejection of conventional therapies. Clearly, they each have their place. And we also want to avoid uncritically accepting the therapies because they are alternative. And as I'll show you, there's a real problem there's a real misconception that many of these therapies, because they are quote unquote natural, and that's a big issue, they are inherently safe, which is not at all the case, particularly when you're talking about herbals and dietary supplements. MCCAM is the National NIH Center, the National Center for Complementary and Alternative Medicine, and they've sort of given a nice little outline of just what we're talking about when we say these, you know, different therapies. We can talk about alternative medical systems, and these are things that have a strong tradition, like traditional Chinese medicine or Asian medicine, Japanese medicine, Ayurveda, which is the healing system of India. And these are very comprehensive philosophies of health and healthcare. Body-based systems, we're talking things like massage therapy, chiropractic, mind-body medicine, meditation, guided imagery, stress relief practices, bioelectromagnetics. There's a lot of interesting work going on right now in rheumatism and joint pain and low back pain and the use of magnetics. Herbal medicine, obviously, nutritional approaches, and pharmacological therapies, which I won't get too deep into that. But like, just as an example of some of these I've already mentioned, but also energy medicine, homeopathy, which is, if you're not already familiar, is essentially using very, very extremely dilute concentrations of certain substances derived from plants and minerals. The idea is that these substances have a kind of energy in them that is useful in drawing out the body's own healing powers. I mean, I'm not really doing justice to the complexity of homeopathy and what it really is, but Reiki is another one. How many of you are familiar or have ever heard of Reiki? a few. But again, it's kind of a laying on of hands, or although there is no, you don't actually touch the patient, but there's a lot of, it's a sort of a sending of energy. It has a lot of similarities with therapeutic touch and some of those therapies. But one of the things about moving to this model of integrative medicine, and one of the reasons we're here at the center, is you know, if we're going to move towards a model that looks at body, spirit, and mind, we really need to look at our own role as healers and as healthcare practitioners, and what example we're setting for our patients, and how we can improve our own lifestyle and model that for our patients. So I like to show this particularly to the first year medical students who have extremely high levels of stress and many of these problems. You know, because if we look at what the killers are, if we look at the top 10 killers in this country, 7 out of 10 of them, and you could probably argue more of those, are directly related to lifestyle issues, okay? Alcohol abuse, lack of exercise, poor diet, smoking, unhealthy responses to stress, many of which include alcohol abuse, smoking, and these things. So the need to look at the social context and the cultural context and the spiritual context, the spirit, body, and mind of an individual is key in addressing these factors. Just another more, you know, practical reason why we should be interested in this field is a number of conventional medications were originally derived from plant substances. Just to give you an example, diabetes example, metformin, which is one of the most, you know, commonly used drugs for diabetes, was originally developed from a plant called goat's rue, which is also called French lilac. It was research on that plant that led to the development of metformin. And there's lots and lots and lots of plants out there and chemicals that we have not really looked at. Also, from an international health perspective, the World Health Organization estimates that 80% of the world's of the people in developing countries rely primarily, if not exclusively, on traditional medicine, which is largely composed of herbal medicine. But here in the U.S., and this is coming out of work that was a big national survey that was done in the 90s, a series of surveys, but basically that kind of put this stuff on the map, which showed that individuals, more individuals see a complementary and alternative medical provider in a given week than see primary care providers. Now, there's some debate about how we define what counts as a complementary provider or an alternative provider. But nonetheless, it's a significant portion of individuals, you know, are using these things. Furthermore, this use is increasing steadily. Since we've begun these national surveys and studies, we're seeing increasing rates of use of people turning to this. And I think it's at least in part a reflection of some of the problems in our own healthcare system. Problems of access, problems of quality. The other issue is that a high proportion, almost all the surveys that we've done and are doing, are showing that most folks that are using these complementary therapies and alternative therapies are not discussing it with their primary care provider, which means that, you know, which in at least, you know, some cases is not a problem, but it does mean that the potential for herb drug interactions, for example, or supplement drug interactions is not really going on monitored, which can be a problem, particularly in the elderly, who may be on a number of prescription drugs. But the other reason is we're finding some efficacy in some of these therapies. I mean, so, you know, I talk about, when I talk to people about this, I say, look, these are just tools that, why would you not want to increase the size of your toolbox of things that you can draw on to be a good healer, you know, regardless of where they come from. As I mentioned, so herbal use in particular has grown from during the decade of the 90s, herbal medicine use in the U.S. increased by 380%. There was no increase in the numbers or the proportion of people discussing or dialoguing with their primary care providers. So this is of concern. As I mentioned, there's this very common misconception that because these are natural, they're somehow more safe. Particularly the herbal medicine products and the dietary supplement products are not regulated in the same manner as conventional medications. This is changing, but there are some serious concerns, some quality concerns. There have been a few studies that have done where they pulled products like these off the shelves and run some chemical assays, and we found some of them contaminated with lead. We've seen pesticides. This is particularly of concern here because some pesticides that have been banned in the U.S. are still commonly used in Latin America. So the extent to which some of these products may have residues from these pesticides is largely unknown. And we have found similar things. Most of the studies have looked at traditional Asian remedies, but they've also found pharmaceuticals. They've been sort of spiked with pharmaceuticals. So this seems to be a problem, particularly with sort of alternative therapies for sexual enhancement and Viagra kind of knockoff drugs and stuff being actually spiked with Viagra or some other pharmaceutical. So the quality concern is real and needs to be addressed. I'm going to kind of skip through a couple things. Again, you know, these slides are just documenting the magnitude of the use of these therapies in our population. This is the most recent national survey by the CDC that asked questions specifically on complementary and alternative medicine. And one of the things that really popped out was the very important role that spirituality and prayer play in people's approach to their health, but also natural products, and that includes supplements and herbs. Among these top natural products, the most popular nationwide are these four. These are sort of the four biggies. And these are not necessarily the top four here in South Texas or in among Mexican Americans. However, one of the things that's interesting is that these are increasingly, as the marketing gets more aggressive and as these products become more popular, they are becoming more popular. They are sort of supplanting some of the more traditional therapies like manzanilla and a number of other products, which I'll show you some slides that we did. These are just some of the conditions that people most frequently turn to alternative therapies for or complementary therapies. Pain is a biggie. Pain, back pain, joint pain, neck pain. Colds, minor colds, head and chest colds, but also anxiety and depression. And, you know, because the focus of my talk, I'm trying to keep it around diabetes, you know, anxiety and depression are frequently comorbid with diabetes, as are the aches and pains of getting older. This, again, this is just documenting that the National Center was actually founded in 92 and just, mirroring. Yeah, I know, it's amazing, it's been there. But you can see the budget, how it's increased over the last decade. Again, mirroring the importance, the nationwide trend of using these therapies, we need to be doing some good research and good studies on the ration people's use of these things. I'm gonna skip some of this because I want to keep it focused more sort of on our population in South Texas, because one of the issues is that these national surveys, which have found, you know, that alternative therapy use tends to be more common among women, tends to be more common among higher educated individuals, higher income people, because they're paying out of pocket for these things. The problem with these national surveys is that they frequently are not done bilingually. Our center has just completed the first Spanish language survey of 2,000 individuals randomly sampled throughout Texas, and we're analyzing the data right now.
Was it a mail survey?
No, it was a telephone survey.
Okay, so we're still not really getting it.
No. No, no, because in particular, although we did, we oversampled along the border, and we got a pretty good, we got very good range of acculturation levels and stuff, but no, we also, particularly along the border in the colonias where there are not as many phones, and we would expect the use of many of these to be even higher. But the reason I bring this up is that these national trends do not necessarily apply to the specific populations that we have here in South Texas. Although what does appear to apply is that folks with chronic conditions, such as diabetes, older individuals do tend to turn to these therapies more frequently than younger, healthier individuals. Let me just, I'm going to skip that because we can come back to this. As I mentioned, that really there's, the difficulties in studying this in Texas is like I said, there's really, we've done the only study and we're still crunching the numbers and figuring out. The most of the studies have been based on sort of small convenience samples of unique clinical populations. And they tend to just be very descriptive, rather than looking, at particular rates or the rationale behind the use. So there's a lot of work to be done. But what we are finding is that the use of folk medicine, particularly herbs, among Mexican Americans, is very high, and is also significantly higher than the use in non-Hispanic, Anglo, and African American populations, as you can see. One survey of type 2 diabetes patients in Los Angeles found that nearly 80% reported using herbal products. Now, many of these are probably also taking conventional prescription drugs. Here, Sandy Burge and I, she did this survey, and we've been working together on this, looking at the data from this cross-sectional survey of primary care, six primary care clinics throughout South Texas, 80% of whom were Hispanic. And again, we found a majority of individuals had used at least one of the alternative therapies. I think we gave them 28 different, list of different options, and had them check off which ones they had used in the last 12 months. Most people use more than one. Very few people are just talking or dialoguing about this with their physicians or their nurses. And herbal teas were the most popular. Just another small study that was done with 120, 60-60, again, just sort of reinforces the idea that Mexican Americans tend to turn to herbal medicines at rates higher than non-Hispanics, particularly herbal medicines. And again, very few are discussing it, and there are a number of reasons why they're not discussing it. Some of which is they don't think it's relevant, they don't think it's a big deal, or that there is some fear that the physician or the nurse may kind of be skeptical and look down on them. We can talk about that a little more if you want to. When we look at this by ethnicity, I mean, one of the striking things are some of the manual therapies like massage and chiropractic are much less frequently used among Mexican Americans. Yoga, things like that, are more common among Anglos, whereas herbal medicines. Now, this difference in pattern, however, seems to be closing over the years as the marketing and as this stuff hits the mainstream more. So it'll be interesting to see how that changes. But like I said, Sandy Burge and I are working on a paper right now looking at some of the data. That basically what we found was that, about close to 30% of the primary care patients, of the Hispanic primary care patients, were using herbal medicines. What we found particularly interesting, though, is we also asked them how effective they thought these therapies were if they used them. Herbal medicine ranked fourth in the frequency of use. Okay, it was the fourth most frequently used alternative therapy from a list of, I think, 28 that we gave them. But it was ranked number one in the proportion of its users who said it was a cure or very effective, which we thought was very interesting. So among Mexican Americans, herbal medicine use is quite common, and perceived to be very effective. We also found that among Hispanic herbal medicine users, a large majority were also using over-the-counter drugs and prescription medications. So one of the things we're doing right now is we're looking at the specific prescription drugs that they were taking and known or hypothesized drug interactions and seeing which ones may be dangerous. I can tell you just off, you know, just anecdotally so far, probably the majority of them are fine. But again, as with any medicine, herbal or otherwise, it's all in the dosing and it's all in the frequency of use and the duration of use. So, and you run higher, the longer you're taking certain herbals, the more potential there is for complications. Furthermore, there's the quality control issue. Are they getting what they think they're getting when they buy these products in a botanica or in a store? Now, and that's a real concern. Let me see. This was another excellent study that was done of traditional plant remedies among diabetes patients here in Texas, South Texas, using the same six primary care clinics, documenting, you know, again, about half, we found higher rates. Individuals who had more diabetes-related hassles, and there's a scale to kind of measure that, how much diabetes is interfering with their life, their daily life, were more likely to turn to these therapies. Although the actual disease severity was not, but to the extent to which it interfered with their day-to-day functioning was a predictor of whether they would turn to herbals. CAM users equally likely to use conventional medicine, and actually that's what we're finding as well, which is telling us, and this is very important, that these are not particularly herbal medicines, at least among Mexican Americans in South Texas, are not seen as an alternative. They're not turning to these things in rejection of the conventional healthcare system. They're using whatever is at their means. It's very much complementary as opposed to alternative. And to them, there is not this sort of necessarily a very strong distinction between conventional healing and an alternative healing. Healing is healing. There's good medicine and bad medicine, wherever it comes from. Some of the popular things, some of the ones I brought down, diabetyl is often a combination of a lot of these other herbs. But the biggie, really, the big one is Nopal, which is cactus, prickly pear cactus, which we have in abundance here. And also this Tronadora tachoma species down here. This is that yellow trumpet flower that's everywhere on campus. Like, you'll see it all over the place. That's what this is. It's a very popular diabetes remedy. And there's been some excellent work done on that plant, but also Nopal. All of this research has been done in Mexico, has been done by the National Health Service in Mexico. We're way behind them in terms of looking at this stuff from a basic science perspective, and they're finding some really interesting stuff, which I'll show you a couple. This is, you know, prickly pear. We all know this well, if we're from this area. Can be slice it up, peel it, boil it, slice it up, eat it with eggs. Can put it in a licuado, like blender with aloe juice and a couple other stuff. Drink it like a shake, very, very popular. But these studies that have been done in Mexico are definitely showing, well, first of all, it's very high in soluble plant fibers, which we know can be beneficial for diabetes and blood glucose. But the studies from in Mexico, which some have been done with humans, but very small ones, majority have been done with rabbits and dogs, looking at alloxin-induced diabetes, and then they give them infusions of Nopal and other plants, and then look at their blood glucose levels, and clearly is showing an effect, a blood glucose lowering effect of Nopal. Now this is great, but it also raises the issue as if a diabetes patient is also taking conventional prescription medications for their diabetes to lower their blood sugar, and they are taking this, I mean, there is a possibility of some synergy going on, and you may get, you know, you don't want to bring the blood sugar down too low. So again, it's one of those things that you probably ought to be asking about and probably need to be monitoring to some extent. Let me see. Real briefly, and then we can just kind of open it up. I want to mention culture in the framework of diabetes and Mexican Americans because of some work that we're finding, some stuff we've been doing down on the border, but it's also, we're finding here in San Antonio as well, some focus groups and all with diabetics that are giving us some interesting ideas about how patients see the problem of diabetes and its causes. You know, there have been a number of attempts to try to understand why Hispanic adults with diabetes experience a higher rate of complications than Anglos do. And a lot of the, you know, some of the hypothesized reasons are that, you know, they're underusing screening and treatment modalities. Could be our diabetes education is not very effective for this particular population. Or then there's that horrible word, non-compliance, that they're not following the advice. But what we're finding is that the way an individual views disease can very much help explain what motivates that person to seek care and may influence what kinds of educational strategies will work for them. And just to give you an example, you know, that the objective, you know, what we think of as a clear-cut objective illness is very much molded, and how it's expressed is very much molded by the cultural beliefs of an individual. Arthritis or rheumatism is recognized as a, you know, in the medical literature as a degenerate joint disease appearing mainly in older populations or as a sequel to joint injury. This condition is found in all cultures. We see it everywhere. And radiological assessments portray, you know, we see degenerating joints, patients indicate weakness, pain, pressure or movement, pain upon pressure or movement, swelling, deformity, atrophy and shortening of the muscles, all easily observed, you know, by a trained eye. With such objective evidence of what this condition is, we would expect people who suffer from it to express their discomfort in similar ways. But we don't. Reports of this illness vary systematically among culturally different populations. Different cultural populations express this discomfort and how they understand it in very different ways, and ways that can be predictive. They may respond, Americans of similar ethnic backgrounds even, within an ethnicity. I mean, these things frequently do not fall along, you know, what we think of as ethnic lines. All Hispanics are not alike. All Anglos are not alike. All African Americans are not alike. We learn different ways to respond to similar symptoms and how we express them. And the one of the reasons I bring this up is that one of the primary reasons people are turning to alternative therapies is not that they don't like medicine. It's not that they don't like conventional healers. Although they do have some concerns with some of the problems in our healthcare system. But what they're looking for, and what I think all of us look for when we're ill, is a participatory experience of empowerment and authenticity when illness threatens your sense of intactness. We try to make sense. Conventional medicine is extremely good at explaining the how of illness. How does diabetes work? What is the mechanism? What changes in the body? It's much less good at explaining why. Why did I get diabetes? Why did I get diabetes now? Or any other condition, why? And yet it's this question that is often at the forefront of somebody's mind when they fall ill. Why did it happen to me? But the reason I mention this is also that some of these folk illnesses like Susto, which is a fright illness, we can talk about a little more if you'd like in question and answer, but mal de ojo, which is kind of the evil eye, and nervios, which is kind of a lay idiom of psychological distress and anxiety, and the extent to which these overlap with conventionally defined syndromes like depression or anxiety disorder, generalized anxiety disorder, are disputable. Nervios is not exactly the same thing as generalized anxiety disorder. Susto, fright illness, what is that? I mean, we don't have the vocabulary for that. It overlaps, some of the symptoms overlap with post-traumatic stress disorder, but not exactly. The reason I bring this up is, and just somebody with Susto, for example, you know, these are some of the frequent symptoms with Susto. I'm leading up to something with the diabetes link here. But Susto, essentially, it's a condition that results from some sort of triggering event, a frightening or traumatic experience, seeing a dog hit by a car, somebody slamming a door and it frightens you. Subsequently, you fall ill with this condition called Susto. It's been linked to, you know, hypoglycemia, has some similarities with hypoglycemia, but not exactly. Again, the symptom profile is not precisely the same. Depressive disorders. It's also been linked to social role strain, which we won't go into, but just the idea that individuals who are not sort of meeting what they believe to be their role in society, to put it in a nutshell, are more likely to suffer from Susto. Why, we don't really know. But what we find when we talk to elders and Mexican Americans in particular here in Texas and South Texas about diabetes and their experience with diabetes is they very much attempt to connect their diabetes to answer this question of why. Why do I have diabetes and why do I have it now and why did I get it? To their own personal life and history. And one of the ways they do this is through this framework of Susto. There's a very common belief that Susto is a cause of diabetes. That Susto or fright illness or a traumatic event brings on diabetes. And it's something that I don't think is very much addressed in any of our outreach literature or patient counseling or anything. We really do not talk about this. Yet when we ask people, you know, how did you get diabetes? Why did you get diabetes? These are some of the things we hear. I got diabetes when a child drowned in front of me. I mean, how many Anglos would say that? I mean, just that first sentence. Or African Americans even. So this is just one of those interesting examples of how culture very much shapes our framework for how we interpret and respond to, because one of the things we're interested in now in looking at is there a difference between, let's just look, say Mexican Americans who attribute their diabetes to Susto versus those who attribute it to something else, genetics, poor diet, whatever. Does the fact that this group attributes it to Susto impact their care-seeking behavior and the remedies and treatments they use? Because Susto has a number of sort of traditional remedies associated with it and rituals that are associated to cure it, our hunch is that yes, they will deal with their diabetes slightly differently. But this is an area we'd like to look at. Another individual who responded that their diabetes was caused by some accidents, occupational accidents in which a tire exploded and blew the person upwards. There's also some interesting, and we do know that stress, you know, the link between heightened stress and glucose control, you know, there may be kernels of truth in this, in that certainly when individuals get stressed, their blood sugar control gets more difficult to, you know. And whether or not these incidents represent an actual cause, or whether they're sort of post hoc explanations for why they got it, you know, we don't really know. But again, it's worth exploring. Let me skip that. Some of the other things we're looking at is we're looking at how individuals make sense of their diabetes, and you know, there's an idea that you know, you can eat whatever you want as long as you eat small portions. For example, that's a very common, for lack of a better term, folk belief. The 8 grams, where is 8 grams coming from? Like, where is that number? Where is the patient getting that number? Where are they coming up with it? These are learned beliefs. We're finding, for example, that there's a fear among some elders that insulin is addictive, or that can cause blindness. The other thing is kind of, one of the things I'm also involved in is you know, when we advise a Mexican American elder that they need to exercise more, well, what exactly are we talking about? Do we mean the same thing when we say exercise that they understand as exercise? And this came up really, it was really interesting. We were talking to some elders down at one of the nutrition centers, and you know, the males in particular were like, no, we don't like to exercise. We don't blah blah blah, but they love to dance. And, well, dancing's not exercise. Well, no, that's not exercise. So they'll do that because it's not exercise. Well, this is wonderful. Let's use that. If that's a cultural belief or a community belief, then let's take advantage of it and use it. But we need to know what these beliefs are and where they conflict and where they don't, so that we can shape our educational messages, our counseling of patients, our public health messages to the beliefs and work with them rather than against them. So I guess I'll stop there and just kind of open it up for questions. If you all have any specific interests or questions about either diabetes or about the evidence for particular therapies, I'll do my best. This is a relatively, there isn't a lot of data out there. There is a lot of research going on. So, you know, we may not know the answers, but do you have any questions or?
Yeah. Our last stroke reference book, I looked up Joe's online while working, and this is the first book I've really seen that had a lot of, it had a total section on herb and different, I guess, natural things that could work with. But every one of the 5 that you put up is one I write on every reference as, don't take this while you're taking this. And so, in this semester, I when they come in and start talking, out of conversation, I try and ask, huh, do you take any of these? Because they don't, you know, they say no, or, well, yeah, or I heard about it. Or, and I tell them I don't know a lot about it, but this is something that comes up on the sheet.
Yeah.
But that's the first time I've ever seen it really, and we now put it on our sheet for a patient if they have a curve. And that's the first time I've ever seen that it's in a book.
Yeah. So your primary, when you get folks saying that they do, which ones do they tend to be? Ginkgo?
It's actually
or any of them, any and all.
Yeah,
I mean,
these are the only ones I really had.
Yeah.
These are the 5 that were on there were really the ones they knew about. Or, you know, they're taking calcium. Not anything like that, but this is the main.
Well, and I mean, of those, you know, garlic, for example, the garlic supplements, you know, which is often used to lower cholesterol and prevent age-related vascular changes and stuff like that. There have been a number of studies with over close to 3,000 people and five double-blind randomized controlled trials. The results are mixed. Some of the studies show efficacy and some don't, and it appears to be, and this is one of the common problems. Of course, this is a problem not just with alternative therapies, but with conventional medications trials, is that you know the preparation used in each of those studies is different. And that's a problem. And we need, and that's why the federal funding for this research is so important, because to do the studies well and with a large enough sample of patients and with the standardized extracts that we need to use to really test these things, it costs a lot of money. So, you know, this is one of those reasons it's important to advocate for this funding to do this research, because the folks are using it. Because I can guarantee a lot more are using it than are telling you they're using it. And some of it may be helpful. Certain preparations of it may be helpful. Echinacea, for example, has been shown to, or not echinacea, I'm sorry, St. John's wort, has been shown in several trials to be effective as Prozac, essentially, for mild depression. Severe depression, no, there doesn't seem to be, but it does appear to be beneficial. So and have a, for some individuals at least, have a better safety profile. But again, you always bump up against this quality issue if they're not, you know. That's right.
That could be very, well,
you get the synergistic effect that can be dangerous, yeah. And again, that's why it's important to be asking and to say, you know, okay, well, if you're going to try this, we need to get you off of that a little bit. And, you know, if it doesn't work for you, maybe we can talk about going back there. But, those are really important concerns.
Do you know by any chance if our medical and dental students are getting any of the complementary and alternative medication uses, as well as the drug interactions, the drug and nutrient interactions that occur with these?
Well, I teach a fourth year, so a selective for the fourth year medical students. Okay.
So it's not required yet?
No, and we're working on that. We just received a grant, a three-year grant from the American Medical Students Association. And the goal of the grant is essentially to integrate some of this stuff. I mean, because all the students, this is what they tell us. They say, this is great. We didn't know any of this was out here. Why did we not hear about St. John's wort and the studies that have been done on it during our psych rotation? Or during our, you know, it makes a lot more sense for it to be, you know, a slide here, integrated here, and a slide there. And that's what we're doing over the next 3 years. We're going to be working to stick it in the curriculum where appropriate. And it's a lot of legwork, and you know, because you got to talk to each individual professor, and some of them aren't real amenable to this, and others are very, very excited and want them to get this data. But by and large, I can say as of now, the large majority of the medical students have very little knowledge. And I ask them, I say, well, you know, do you ever talk to your patients about this stuff? And they say, no, not really. Well, why? Because we wouldn't know what to tell them if they told us they were taking. They're opening up a black box that they wouldn't know what to say in response. And there are a number of really excellent tools out there to search for herb-drug interactions, for example. No, they're not yet very familiar with them, and we're really working on that.
Have we required them to use the palm or one of those operating bases? Because I think that's another area where it might be extremely helpful. There's a lot of those herbals online, like Hippocrates, that'll do the drug.
And that's what we're going to be. That's one of the things I really want to work on is you know, making sure that they have that and they know that it's there. And stay tuned, because this is the.
Well, I have an idea. We're putting in for a big Reynolds Center grant, and we're going to focus on geriatrics in the medical curriculum. And I think this could be a component of that. And
absolutely,
we're going to be meeting with all the basic science faculty and all the clinical faculty. So
I would love to be a part of that.
Definitely be in touch with that.
Yeah, because again, to what extent are these issues of Susto being addressed or talked about, and what implications might they have for how how the patient responds. And we need to, you know, we need to be dialoguing about this.
Talking about Susto, you know, if you were a friend, the simplest thing you could do is just go get some granules of sugar and take it. Mm-hmm. And I know this is how it is with girls. So the other day, a girl was sitting there and dashed into my office and found sugar. You know, it's like it's because it ties together to the same hypoglycemia. Mm-hmm. But it's very common. And a lot of these things also stem from what are called nichos, which people believe in.
Yeah.
The idea of just eating a little bit of something like that from the nicho is
all things in moderation. It's, I mean, yeah.
Yeah. That's why there's no way that you can separate.
Yeah. And in some, you know, I mean, I'll give you an example I love to use about why this, why those beliefs, those details, are so important and that we need to understand them well. Is just to give you an example from the international health scene, is there was a big campaign in Latin America, in Ecuador, in some of the indigenous communities to get oral rehydration packets for childhood diarrhea. We had high rates of infant mortality because of the diarrhea, easily treatable, preventable stuff. So I can't remember if it was PAHO or one of the big orgs produced all these packets, okay? And the villagers weren't using them. They were not using them. And they were in little red packets. And they didn't know why, they couldn't figure out why, so they called in some anthropologists, came down and started talking to them. Well, started talking to them, their idea, there's a very prominent thing throughout Latin America having to do with hot-cold illnesses. There are certain illnesses that are hot and certain illnesses that are cold, and they don't necessarily coincide exactly with what we would think of as hot, like fever and stuff. I mean, they may, but they may not. There's other illnesses. Well, childhood diarrhea, from their local sort of explanatory model, was a hot illness. And red is a hot color. So you certainly wouldn't want to treat it with a red therapy. So all they did was they changed the color of the packet, and sure enough, they used them. I mean, little things like that, little simple things, but if we don't know what those beliefs are and the framework, the explanatory framework of our patients is, you know, we can run up into some real difficulties.
You mentioned Reiki, and maybe I've
heard more about craniosacral therapy. Craniosacral is a massage therapy focusing on this area, used for a number of things. It's kind of, does anybody here have any experience with craniosacral? I don't know a whole lot about it, but I think it's akin to like lymph massage, lymph drainage, and stuff like that. So it involves, you know, a particular kind of massage therapy focused on the cranium and upper body. Anybody else? Comments? Questions?
Well, we have this whole curriculum in ethnogeriatrics, which has a lot of this kind of information in it. And I think, you know, we're really focusing on Mexican-American issues because of where we are geographically.
Sure.
But we also have populations of Vietnamese, we have populations in this city.
Yeah.
There are Chinese families here who have been here since before the state became a state.
Yeah.
And they have their own bunch of beliefs that we have to be, I think, trained in.
Well,
we really need to know this stuff.
And it's fascinating because when I was going around all these botanicas in town, and one of the things that's really striking and how they're kind of changing over the years is many of the immigrants from other places, Middle Eastern countries, for example, India, are gravitating towards these traditionally Mexican-American shops because they are sort of, and I believe it's because they're more similar, more comfortable, or they're more familiar with the kinds of things that they're used, the markets, and the kinds of things that are in their home countries. And so but what's interesting is, so now you'll see books on Buddhism and books on Ayurveda and Indian medicine in these botanicas, which, you know, traditionally are sort of Mexican American. So there's a real blending of these different approaches. And that's an area, I mean, particularly along the coast, the Vietnamese populations and the, you know, we have a lot of Asian immigrants in Texas along our East Coast, and you know, so yeah, there, and they have traditional Chinese medicine and Asian medicine is a very well developed theory and framework for understanding illnesses. And if you've never read this very popular book called The Spirit Catches You and You Fall Down, it's a wonderful book. If you get a chance, it's about this culture conflict and how an immigrant family deals with some of these issues and the conflicts between their traditional therapies and their conventional care. It's kind of a tragic story, but it's a wonderful book. So anyway.
Thank you very
and
much.
And feel free to contact me. I've got my card if you want to email me or anything.
One pill makes you larger.